Oh. Okay, looks like we are live. We're live. Great. Amazing. Yay. Okay. Welcome to session three, Becoming the Regenaissance, Design Science Studio Salon, featuring creators from all over the world who are regenerating culture, catalyzing cultural change, and change across so many different spheres to support a transition to a world that works for all of life. We have scientists, we have designers, we have artists, we have systems thinkers from all over the world, and it's been an incredible day featuring so many members of third cohort of the Design Science Studio and many from the first two, partners, visionaries, friends. It's been really incredible. Really delighted. My name's Roxy again. I am but one of many team members who have come together to create this day to uplift so many artists. And we're hosted on the Vision Train. In just a little bit, we'll get to hear from Alicia Sacred Heart, co-founder of the Vision Train. It's a nonstop art train jam open all the time on Zoom. And if you've never hopped on the Vision Train, it is a home for creativity. So definitely check it out. Okay, next up, we have Vincent Wu. I'm so delighted and excited to get to have this next initiation. It is a hip hop energetic encoding. And Vincent Wu also goes by Vintage. And so Vintage was born and raised in the concrete jungles of New York City, indigenously known as the Lenape lands. And there he became a universal soul to carry a torch that was held by many past revolutionaries to further the evolution of human civilization. Being a student of one of the forefathers of hip hop, David Nelson of the Last Poets, and Jan Lucanus, a three times world Tai Chi champion, whilst being guided by spirit and elders of our world. Through medicine ceremonies and life experiences, he is on a mission to co-create a regenerative ecosystem for those who wish to live a life beyond Babylon. So delighted to have you with us today, Vintage. Let's kick it off. Welcome, welcome.
Peace, peace. What's up, family? It is an honor to be here. And some brilliant minds up in here, I'll say that. Lots of dope poetry and workshops and everything. I've been enjoying myself. But yeah, I've channeled this EP, and I say channel because one day I was just kind of like looking at beats because I decided to take music more seriously, and lyrics just started streaming to my mind, and it was just like scriptures and stuff. So yeah, it was like a channeling, but there's like a code in my EP. So like there's three stages. I like working with the number three because of Nikola Tesla, and you know about the number three, free energy, and like it's the secrets to the universe. And so yeah, there's three stages of this sequence. And this can be applied to anything really. So when energy comes at us, we must surrender. We surrender to it, and then we cultivate it, we transmute it, and then we let it back out. And so in that sense, we are a conduit for energy, right? And being a clean conduit of energy is all that we are trying to be, really, because that's what many may call evolving or, you know, healing and all that. So yeah, the first song is called Healing, which I am going to share now. Share sound. Bang, bang, hopefully you guys are hearing it. Doing the best we can and navigating through the chaos. No need to make it harder and hurt one another. We only fight because we can't communicate what our hearts really want to communicate. But let the mind be guided by the heart and
feel it.
You can let me know or you can let it go. Don't hold it in till it explodes. Talk it out, walk it out, let it flow head to toe. Plant seeds, non-GMO, let it grow. Tap into the love, tap into the hope, let it show. We can vibe or we can try to unalive, let me know. I'm with whatever, but I'd rather dead the woes and get close to the core of our being. Explore more than what our eyes are seeing. It's a whole wild world within. Access the web by tuning in. Even when confined, we be zooming in. Cause love rules everything around me. Green chakra, get the prana. I do this for the love, y'all. I do this for the love, y'all. I'm just a conduit of love, y'all. Fluent and moving with love. Through the illusions is tough. So take a deep breath and puff. Then please open up to receive the love. And if you need to grieve, here's a hug. Feel free to leave when it's enough. No limits, no bounds. We're free to smile, free to frown. Feel free to feel the sounds. From the root to the crown, this is truth encoded in the sound. No more illusions eroding in our towns. We only allowing what's aligned to be around. Matter of fact, we align, so we divine, aligning everything around. Yeah. You can let me know or you can let it go. Don't hold it in till it explodes. Talk it out, walk it out, let it flow head to toe. Plant seeds, non-GMO, let it grow. Tap into the love, tap into the hope, let it show. We can vibe or we can try to unalive, let me know. I'm with whatever, but I'd rather dead the woes and get close to the core of our being. Magic, explore more than what our eyes are seeing. Magic unlocks when one starts believing. No deceiving, simply start breathing. Deep into the belly, let the code seep in. And help me share this message of love, healing, and activation. As we arrive at the same page, the same revelation. And this dance floor is the journey and the destination. And in here, you could dance, you could fly, you could just live your life. You could hide, you could even cry and pout. You could also wild out, you could vibe out. Maybe shake your thighs now and move your hands, your knees, your chest, and freely express.
You're already the best at being you. You came with a unique set of codes to share with our world. So keep being you, exactly as you are. Feel into your body and let the energy, the poetry flow out however it wants to flow out.
Yeah, that was my song called Healing. So communication, right? Lines of energy, letting it flow. No blockages, just let it flow, you know?
Oh, it's epic. Yeah. By the way, if you click share screen and then advance and your computer audio, it'll just show the audio.
Can you repeat that one more time? It's hard to hear you.
Yeah. So click share and then click advance and then click computer audio, and it'll only show the audio and not the screen. Unless you want the screen.
Oh, okay. I hear what you're saying.
Yeah.
All right.
You can see me bigger. It's not even moving.
Okay, the next song, after we done healing and done letting that energy flow, we're cultivating our truth, right? So this song is gonna be called My Truth.
We each have our own personal relationship to the Most High, to God, to Spirit. So how can we judge another for that? We shouldn't. Hey yo.
This is my truth, ain't no one else's. This is my book, my sketches. You could take a look but don't stretch it. Cause this is my life, my perspectives. No need to have it reflected, but learn and respect it. Cause check it, this is my life. My collections, my selections, my sight. My personal perceptions of the light. See, we could share our angles, right? But don't intrude with obtuse thoughts unless we tight. I defend, but I never start a fight. Never been marked by the darkness in its plight. Cause from early on I felt the darkness. Materializing art that'll take us to new heights.
Materializing art that'll take us to new heights.
It's a feeling greater than a knife up a traitor's shin. Like when our prayers went past the player's sins. God is blasting the creator's hymns. But yo, the line is razor thin. So honor my boundaries and now do the same. If not, you're calling upon pain. And why would you want that? Why resort to physical combat? See, we with the shits, but we beyond that. They bomb, we bomb back. Man, people just want their moms back.
and not feel wrong to be black. No, we all simply wanna sing songs back to back. No need for the napalms or the gats. Matter of fact, no need to even be calm or relaxed. Express your emotions, just open up your palms and we can chat. How they not seeing that? There's not just one way to live. To enforce that is simply sick. So fuck the forces that swiftly slip. Those over having conversations that gently sit and float. Sometimes we gotta let it marinate and grow. So take your time, be patient and flow. Don't fake being alive, go meditate and you'll know that we came from the whole. So tune in, past illusions from the brain to the soul. We the same and it shows. Check beyond the window frames deep below. You feel the flames, never freezing cold. Even in the seasons with no hope. Just believe in what's beyond. Angels and demons, a limited scope. And if not, just know that this is my truth. Ain't no one else's. This is my book, my selections, my selections, my... I messed up again. I'm sorry. It's all good.
Need to have it reflected.
No need for perfection.
Cause check it.
This is my life, my collections, my selections, my sight, my personal perceptions of the light. Yeah. What's my song called? My Truth. Because that's where we ground into our truth, right? Because we each have our own individual experiences that we harness and cultivate and that we share with the world. And so sharing it is going to be the next song, releasing it back out. And for this one, I'm actually going to share the music video that I worked on. Let me see. Hold on one second. Okay. All right. It's called The Promised Land.
To the promised land, just promise not to land and fall prey to the commas and the fame, the dollars and the game. Your mama didn't want that for you when she gifted you your name. Let go of the shame, let go of the pain. Use it as fuel, never kneel, get disciplined and train. Stay focused on the mission to reclaim our kingdom. But stay blessed and keep it stable as we win this game of chess and flip the table. We no longer follow rules just cause someone say so. Yeah, we organize cause we all got the same goal. It's time for a changing of the old guards. Recognize the power of a whole heart. Defend, though we really need more art. That's how we'll win, even before wars start. But sometimes we may start to lose hope. Old paradigms got us at the end of our rope. Trauma rooted toxic habits form just to cope. But redirect our scope and aim for what's dope. And know that tribe is always close. So learn how to tune in to see those with an evolution oriented ethos as opposed to what they feeding you through the media. Fake prophets leading you, then leaving you. But us? We going to the promised land. So promise not to land and fall prey to the commas and the fame, the dollars and the game. Your mama didn't want that for you when she gifted you your name. Let go of the shame, let go of the pain. Use it as fuel, never kneel, get disciplined and train. Stay focused on a mission to reclaim. The kingdom of heaven is in you. Sovereignty imbued you, the savior ain't no rescue. That ain't on the menu, I can't even let you codepend. Or the curse ain't never gonna end. This course will loop like zero and one, recycling to ten. Though I see spirals when dropping the egoic lens. Where is the promised land? I'd say it's not really a specific place. There can be many promised lands, but I will say that the right questions will yield the right answers. So if you asked how we get there, I say this.
We going to the promised land, so promise not to land and fall prey to the commas and the fame, the dollars and the game. Your mama didn't want that for you when she gifted you your name. Let go of the shame, let go of the pain. Use it as fuel, never kneel, get disciplined and train. Stay focused on a mission to reclaim
our kingdom. Learn from the elders, learn from the sun, learn from the earth, the
revolution begun way before your birth. See it when you put a stick in the dirt. This shit is cyclic, you can cycle shift it. Ancient knowledge encrypted, gifted to initiates to be admitted back into the infinite.
All right, and that was it. So we have healing, surrendering, and then letting it flow, and then expressing it, releasing it back to the collective. So the toroidal field is complete again. But yes, that is the end of my energetic sequence transmission. Thank y'all, appreciate you. Thank you so much, Roxy. You've been putting in a lot of work, yo. I appreciate you. Man.
It's not just me, it's a whole lot of people, but I'll take it and I'll distribute it. I'll distribute like this, pew, to all the beautiful people helping out, and I'll take it in too. You're welcome. Thank you. Thank you for that transmission. Thank you for your work. Thank you for your gifts. You know what's interesting is next up is Moni, who's also my mom. And I say that because you kept talking about moms. You were like, she didn't want that for you when she gave you her name. I'm like, what? I wonder what she wanted from me when she gave me my name.
I would love to hear that story, actually.
I know, right? Let's definitely have that one.
So beautiful.
Yeah, let's get all the links in the chat. I can also share them in the stream. And thank you, Vintage. This is an amazing EP. I can't wait to see all the places it goes. Honored to be in community with you. Thank you for your gifts. Amazing. All right. Okay. So next up, we have Moni Shohadai, who also happens to be my mom, who's an amazing poet and mother and friend and dancer. She just won an award in Nashville, Tennessee. She was catalyzing a whole like cultural revolution in Nashville, bringing Spanish dance and culture to Nashville early on. She had, I think that the award was, I can't remember the exact award. You might have to tell everyone in the chat, Moni, but I know that it was connected. I wasn't there in person, but I watched the videos and no one told her and they surprised her, which I thought was pretty cool. But I think teaching the first Spanish dance classes there. And now that's like a thriving cultural center that she helped to create and catalyze for a lot of people. So she's an inspiration, she's also an activist. Anyways, she has a bio, but I'm not reading because she's my mom. I can though. So she is sharing with us part of her multiverse poetry journey. So she has been working on a project called Multiverse Poetry since cohort one. And she shares that when she began her journey with the Design Science Studio, her poetry was able to be recovered and have a purpose, and that was regenerated through the interconnected journey of all involved in the stage of our human experience and evolution. And with that, I'm going to share a collaboration actually between Moni and Kevin Slattery and Carlos, who all co-created this piece, which is here and it has an intro and everything. Let's see.
Hello, I am very happy to see you here. My name is Moni Shohadai. I am a member of the Design Science Studio and participant of this amazing event, Design Science Salon. My project is poetry. It will be written in Spanish and English, and also it will have a component of vision through media and voice and music. The name of the project is Multiverse Poetry Journey, and as the name says, it is a journey tracing the path from today, when desperation is in the air, to the end of the decade, when everybody will be able to see the fruits of our regenerescence, our participation. I hope you enjoy it.
This poem is part of the collection Multiverse Poetry Journey, written by Moni Shohadai, member of Design Science Studio. All poems are available in Spanish as well as English. This poem is called Mother Earth, We Will Heal Your Wounds. Walking each morning on a pasture sprinkled with tiny drops of dawn, I could barely feel on my bare feet the beating of your heart. I look at a once upon a time blue sky, now darkened by smog, and I feel your pain. I ran and embraced a now dead tree on the backyard, same tree that witnessed our children's childhood. I could feel your tears falling on my face. I kissed your trunk with hope. I walked to the small creek that runs along our home, and I could feel, running through my fingers, tiny fish struggling to stay alive in a water today polluted by chemicals. I can feel your tears mixed with mine running down my face. I can feel our deep connection. You gave us birth, Mother Earth. Our umbilical cords are still connected. Please, don't lose hope. We, your children, are waking up from a dark dream. Don't lose hope. We love you. We always will. I placed my ears upon the ground. I closed my eyes and I could hear the cry of slaughtered whales and baby dolphins. Don't lose hope, Mother Earth. I can feel your pain. I am a mother too. Hear us out. We are united to heal your wounds, to see your smile again reflected on pristine and clear waters, on blue skies and living trees. Stay awake. Don't lose hope. We love you. We know of our mutual dream to see the smiles of many generations to come. We are your children. Mother Earth, we promise today we're united, and together we will heal your wounds. There's still time to get this done. Film editing, speaker John Ash. Film footage, Creative Commons, the Cosmonaut Collection, and Moni and Z's Film Archives. Written by Moni Shoadai. Music by Carlos Garcon. And spoken word by Kevin Slattery.
Yeah, mom. Oh, an automatic video started playing. Amazing. Yes. So incredible. I want to bring the poet up on the stage, see if she'll join me to share a few words about that poem and your the next evolution of your multiverse poetry journey. Welcome, Moni. You're muted.
So you managed to put me on this spot. I told you, I'm a stage, I don't know. I got stage shy. Is that what you call
it? It can be short. I just want to bring you up here to give some love. Maybe we can just unmute and share some love in the room. A little shout out action.
Yeah. Well done. Beautiful piece.
Yeah, thanks for that.
That was funny. Thank you. Love you. Appreciate your poetry. Appreciate your journey. Appreciate you being my mom. Y'all wouldn't be here.
Somebody asked about what is the name? What's the meaning of your name? Star. Remember?
Bright light, shining star.
So shining star. There you go. See. No, it's an honor to be here, Roxy. You know that. Yeah, no, I will. I think I put it on my description. This is my journey. It's interesting, but people finally will understand that things like this will give purpose to someone's life. That's all I have to say. And thank you for having me here. And I will continue to write more poems that will align with everything we're doing. It's not easy, but I have the muse. See, my poetry is not is not roses or violets or blue, and I love you too. It's a different type of poetry. but I appreciate you inviting me here. And it is amazing. Everything I've seen, everything I hear is like inspiration, motivation. And then I see another artist that is here in Nashville. I just discovered that artist by a video that I actually shared. And it's amazing. I didn't even know. It's a pleasure. I'll let you move on.
Well, the next artist is also from Nashville. We have Mage coming up. And Mage, I know you're kind of bringing in on the family.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, hey Mage.
Awesome, what's going on, y'all? How you doing?
Great, great, great. I know Mage is a big fan of the fam.
Definitely, yeah. I actually have a song I'll be performing that Carlos helped produce, so you know, just extending the love.
That's incredible. Yeah, well, kind of building the bridge between the two of you, both in Nashville, Tennessee, in the United States. And yeah, I just want to thank you, Moni, for your poetry and for all that you've shared about your presence in the studio and that like purpose and that like kind of amplification of what we're doing and how it helps us keep going. So thank you for sharing that. Thanks for being such an inspiration for me. All right, next up we have Brent Hanby, part one of two. Yes. This one is Designed for a Changing World. So we get to hear from Mage, also known as Brent Hanby.
And
you might have caught some of Mage's beautiful work we've been sharing recently. I know some of our social media channels jumping in and co-creating you're doing so much diverse work, and just want to really appreciate all of the amplification of the community that you've been channeling through your art and through your nonprofit that you're going to share with us. But Mage is a bridge builder between traditional and futuristic kind of movements, and really, really honored to, I know Mage through actually deep culture and deep tropics. Mage has been really like helping and, you know, inspire huge amounts of people culturally in Nashville to like party with purpose and, you know, really take care of our waste and be like full cycle. I know that the first time you popped in the Design Site studio was during Regenera, and you were like live in it, you know, doing Earth Guardians, and it was incredible.
So good.
So excited to give you the stage, my dear. Welcome.
Yeah. Yes, yes. I was gonna spring to try to get my Earth Guardian shirt. I might wear it later for the thing, but yeah. So just brief intro. I did recycling and sustainability for years, and everything sounding good. Everybody, give me a thumbs up. We good. Awesome, sweet. So yeah, I did recycling and sustainability for years. And I'm going to share my screen, and I've got a presentation that I'm gonna try to be succinct and concise. I mean concise with. So give me 1 second. All right, that's my waiting room. Awesome, and is that showing up for everybody?
Yep, it's showing up. There's a tiny crackle in your mic, but okay. it's bearable.
And okay, I guess gotcha.
It might be, actually that sounds a little better.
Awesome. Yeah, okay. Let me actually. Sweet. That should be better, actually. So, bam. All right. So, that being said, I introduce to you all, it's Designed for a Changing World. So, what that means and what the intention behind it is that the world's changing. In this first slide, you see irradiated soil, basically dead soil, and it's devoid of life, and then a cityscape in the distance. One of the things that I have noticed by living in Tennessee is that just the lack of planning for green spaces. And what does that mean? That means less, like the air quality suffers from that. The all the concrete. It's basically excessive rainwater runoff, and it makes it to where we got a lot of problems that we need to solve strategically. So to get with it, let's see. Here we go. Boom. So what is mandala? Mandala is a collective connector to catalyze change and collaboration. So we're a organization that pulls together people from STEM communities, from science, technology, engineering, mathematics. So we serve as a coordination organization in the industry experts, university and STEM programs with visionaries, artists to blend tradition with innovation and collectively solve societal and sustainable related issues such as housing, urban green spaces, and renewable energy. And you actually see this is Germantown in North Nashville, and it is just thrown up every week another apartment complex that's basically just a glorified box, and there's cutting down trees, not planning for any type of green spaces, and this is what gentrification looks like. Nashville is known for its ingenuity and its artists and its music scene, and a lot of that is drying up because, well, out of town investors are buying up real estate and rebuilding at unattainable prices for many local natives. Changing climate, obviously, longer summers. We just had a tornado that took out a pretty significant part of a city that's like east of here last night in December. It was 70 degrees and we had a tornado. So there's that. The cost of living, many are struggling to keep up with daily increasing costs of groceries, utilities, interest rates, all the above. And the hold up a second. Okay, so I don't know why my alarm just decided to go off right now. But anyways, so lack of green spaces, industrial impact, landfills are nearing capacity. There's a lot of different things there to consider. So the solution we're working right now, we meaning Mandala, are working with a material science research company or organization based in Mesa Lombarda, Italy, and they specialize in using ecofilaments, clay, porcelain, recycled plastic, different, and they're also looking for trying to come up with a solution for green concrete, because as you might know, concrete is kind of a dirty process. It uses a lot of wastewater and energy in the process. So 3D printed architecture, that's one of the solutions that we're striving for. And you can see up in the corner is actually a structure that's being 3D printed by a upscaled 3D printer that's on a crane. So it's basically, that's the beauty of vector space and polygonal space, is that it can be scaled up infinitely. So it's on a crane. They call it wasp because they're using clay as wasps build their nest. So one of the things here is that you can see you can actually 3D print vertical tower gardens. You can actually 3D print wind turbines. The wind turbine in this slide actually uses recycled plastic as a filament, and the other ones, the tower garden uses porcelain, and then the actual structure is clay. So really incredible technology. We've been in partnership with them, and we're trying to secure one for Tennessee, for Nashville, and then the intention is to create a three-dimensional mandala that's experiential. And the conceptually, a mandala is a journey taking one from suffering into joy. There's painstaking details put into mandalas, but ultimately they become these beautiful images that are temporary, many times to be wiped away. So I'm going to kind of expedite this part right here. 3D printed homes just talks about how low impact construction is scalable for application and custom to each site. So one of the big things that we're really focused on here is to be able to develop workforce and develop skills and meaningful jobs that have impact. So we are actually working with a organization, Magruder Family Resource Center in North Nashville, and they provide a lot of resources for people. And one of the things that we're trying to implement is a 3D printing program that focuses on foster teenagers that are aging out of foster care. So giving them skills to potentially print their own home. There's a lot of homelessness that comes right after foster care. So that our strategy, combining objectives that span academic, industrial, technical, environmental and socioeconomic disciplines, we aim to provide comprehensive research and innovative approach to solve these modern problems. So we already have a MOU with a engineering firm, Pagani Engineering, and it's a Black-owned engineering firm that is multi-generational, and they're just incredible people. Architecture firm, Manuel Zeitlin Architects, they're 56 years old, and they are one of the most progressive specializing in LEED certification buildings and all kinds of progressive projects. So they were naturally excited about this prospect. And the academic, we're working with Vanderbilt and the Wondery and Dan Drogosh there. And there's just a lot of synergy that's happening throughout these different fields. So basically partnering with academia to research and develop. In the mandala, again, we're the collective connectors that catalyze collaboration, because I'm a poet and I love alliterations. So a strategic roadmap, we're trying to print one structure first, and then phase two is going to be the integration of the renewable energy sources in agriculture, and then also data collection, which is actually more of the phase three. And then phase four, which isn't listed here, would be the refinement and scaling up. So from that, I'm going to transition to the other. This is the more visionary aspect. This is the scale up, redefining cohabitation, the agrihood concept. So apparently, agrihood was coined by some people in the Southwest in like 2015 or something like that. And it was marketed to a certain socioeconomic standing, which is great. But I'm all about freedom of information. I'm all about open source technology and maker economy, circular economies. So this here is a image that was rendered with Stable Diffusion, and I basically entered my poetry and my vision of it, and it came to this. So imagine walking into a neighborhood where homes emerge from the ground like living sculptures, each uniquely designed to fit the landscape and the needs of the inhabitants. With 3D printing technology, we can redefine urban living efficiently utilizing space. We're planning on 10 acres, not just building structures, but shaping experiences, relationships, and forging strong sense of belonging. So you can see gardens would be the central aspect of this. And then it kind of looks like a mandala. It almost resembles the Tibetan Buddhist mandalas that usually are in squares with circles and that. So a different type of community. Heart-centered sustainability is the premier axiom of this. Innovative living spaces, integrative learning, holistic well-being, and creating strong community bonds. So from that's we're not just building homes differently, but we are building communities differently. And so then again, imagine a neighborhood where nature is not just preserved but celebrated. Agrihoods center around lush community gardens that serve as focal points for interactions, nourishment, regeneration. And these gardens redefine the concept of communal space, becoming thriving hubs of activity and sustenance. So again, just some more images, AI-assisted generative art, just based off the concepts. And I made this little nested graphic of contemplation being at the center, which is where we're at right now. Feeding into the innovation, feeding into the integration, feeding into the transformation, and then the regeneration that starts the process all over again. So one of our taglines is blending tradition with innovation, traditional farming, meeting new age technology to coalesce in agri-hood's community garden. So regenerative farming practices, which enrich soil ecosystem and merge seamlessly with hydroponic growing arrays. And all these things can be modeled and 3D printed into the structures. I have a vision of a wind garden to have functional art sculptures that are 3D printed turbines that look like flower blossoms, strategically placed to create an experiential 3D mandala. So that's one of the big visions that we are holding there. And this is just about to wrap this up. I haven't been checking the time, but I think I'm still in the window. Get the axioms of permaculture, people care, earth care, fair share, and the agri-hood. It's a heart-based, nature-centric approach to sustainability that utilizes the energy-efficient 3D printed structures. One thing I didn't mention is that no trees have to be cut down. These are and there's little to no waste on these 3D printing structures. It's pretty incredible. Again, with the regenerative farming practices, implementation of hydroponic arrays that are also 3D printed into the structures, and then factoring in for rain catchment, factoring in all these different things, creating a self-contained system, reducing our carbon footprint, promoting balanced, healthy lifestyles, educating and developing a workforce of highly skilled individuals that live what they advocate, and establishing strong communal bonds, a sense of purpose, and personal empowerment. So we're looking for partners, for people to volunteer, to people to help our organization grow. So we're looking for communication, legal, event planning, recruitment, fundraising, and all these things. 3d.mandala.tn@gmail is our email right now. I just just register the website at themandalamovement.org. So it is, you'll see it under construction page if you go to it right now. But if you're interested, just send me an email. And I'm just so grateful to be a part of this community. And we have, got a lot of awesome things to do. So I think that is complete for my share. And I'm really grateful for the stage. I've been loving this program so far.
Wow, Mage, what an incredible vision, and so comprehensive and aligned and beautiful. And I saw a lot of people in the comments wanting to connect and kind of find those synergies. So this is absolutely incredible. We have the schedule. So to move forward, let me introduce Shelvanaya Gabriel. Is a queer transdisciplinary visual artivist conveying nonlinear portals of possibility. So I welcome to the stage Shelvanaya, and happy to.
There we go. Okay. Can you hang on 1 second? Let me actually. Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Perfect. Okay. Thank you. So hello, everyone. Indeed, I am Shelvanaya Gabriel. And I'm taking a moment to switch mindsets and spaces. We'll breathe into this here. So what I wanted to do was to share with you all about it's a project, but it's a concept. It's a lot of different things. It's this multi-layered project called Creative Resilience. I'm trying to remember who was it that said, "Where does the story really begin?" Was that Leah that said that? I'm pretty sure it was. In any event, so the story it begins many places. Yeah. It certainly starts in 2016 when there was a pretty significant shift of energies here in the United States and beyond. And I started making art in a different way than I had been previous to that. Started calling myself a professional artist, started showing my work, selling my work, you know, being seen. And there was a flow of energy between me and my community, communities, in fact. And so I started to begin to shift. So I'm a trained scientist, a chemist, a lab manager. That's sort of one aspect of who I have been in the world. The art started to become a way of integrating a lot of different elements of what I do, because I am also a facilitator and was trained in intergroup dialogue. And it just occurred to me, I wanted to create a dialogue that began with art. So in other words, it's first of all, it was called, I called it the Creative Resilience Dialogues. And for several years, before the pandemic and then through the pandemic, I would hold these spaces where we would gather and hang on 1 second. I'm going to actually attempt to show you. I hadn't intended to do this, but I think it would help. Just slideshow. There we go. Oh. I'll do a little share here. That is not the right. Are you seeing my screen or no? Probably not, right?
Not yet. Oh, it looks like something's coming up. Yep.
There
we go. Okay. All right. Hang on 1 second. Let me get us, there we go. Okay. Apologies if this makes you dizzy. I'm really sorry. Just want to get to the, well, first of all, there's one of the beings in my life, the non-human beings in my life. So this is just kind of how I start out the dialogues. It's, you know, it's about wellness and identity. I'm weaving in my artwork just because I'm trying to sort of connect the fact that my creating is what flowed into building containers with others. And so, you know, this is just a quick overview of how it's organized, how the dialogues, you know, what it looks like. So again, whoops, sorry, that's again more art. And so we make art. I provide a prompt and then send folks off. You know, a lot of them had to be virtual, again, because of the pandemic. So we would, you know, send folks off into breakout rooms and, you know, with a prompt like, what does belonging mean to you? How does oppression live in your body, and how do you feel, you know, how do you enact different identities in the world, you know, things of that nature. And so the prompt or the invitation, well, first of all, we'd sort of talk about active listening to give sort of a context of how to be with each other, how to focus on each other's words. Even if you're in a virtual space, you can still do this, right? You can still notice what words are being used, how words are being used. You can notice, you know, when we're sharing the art, what's in the art, what symbols are in the art, you know, what colors are being used, what textures, you know. Okay, and so we also talked about group norms, you know, things of speaking from one's own experience, etc. And you would always start with this and then sort of add on other, what you know, what else, right? You ask what else do folks need in the space in order to show up fully, to be fully present, you know, and sort of, okay, so, you know, we'd also do introductions, and the introductions are designed to sort of introduce, not so much introduce, but highlight what's in the space. You know, who are you bringing with you? Yourself, but who is that self, and what other selves are here with you? And so, you know, the obvious, you know, things of the typical sort of what name would you like us to call you? Pronouns, I use they, them pronouns. What identities, you know, salient to who you are in this space right now, would you like to share with the group? And that could be any number of things, right? And then, you know, what's challenging, what's bringing you joy, that sort of thing. And so this is just, you know, I think I made this really quick just now. Oops, sorry. So yeah, queer, Black, trans, non-binary, disabled, and multiple ways. Obviously an artist, also a caretaker of different beings, and neurospicy, a student at Hampshire College gifted this name to me instead of neurodivergent. I love it very much. And then what's challenging, holding too much, right? Grief is very much present with me in these times, and not just me, but what's bringing me joy are sweet connections, much like this space, right? Much like my cohort and other groups of that nature. I have chosen family in the audience. Shout out to y'all. Okay. And so, yep, just ask folks to introduce themselves, you know, and, it, you know, at some point, I would love to do this with anyone who wants to do it, right? So again, here's an example, you know, a couple of prompts here. And the invitation is to make art for 5 minutes. You don't, you know, no rules except no words, because the idea is to start the dialogue before words, right? In a nonverbal way, which allows us to tap into other ways of feeling and thinking and being and communicating with each other. And it's amazing what happens.
So then, of course, after that, then there's the sharing, yeah, the small group sharing, where you show your art first, yeah, and then you can say whatever you want to go with that, whatever words go with the visuals, and then the back and forth, and then we come back together as a large group to integrate and figure out, reflect and resonate and re-envision, sort of taking the sort of more lo the local, what you talked about in your small groups, which was this person, and then expand it out. So what themes came up and how can we connect that to who we are elsewhere in the world, and with each other? And so I think this is a mural. Well, it's not a mural. It's a full-sized. So it started as a mixed media painting, and then I sort of created a digital collage from that, and it's actually on display in Holyoke, Massachusetts, here in the U.S. And this is, so really quickly, creative resilience is also a space. So this is Creative Resilience Lab. And I don't think I have, no, I wasn't able to do that. So let me close this and see your lovely faces again. There we go. Hello, everyone. So yeah, so it is also a space. It's an art and performance, creation. We do contemplative work in there. We gather folks. We've had a couple of performances in that space. Artists use it to hold workshops. The idea is to center QT BIPOC, local QT BIPOC artists, other disabled artists, low to no income artists, and just sort of give folks, access to space, access to other kinds of resources, whether it be funding, mentorship, or just honestly witnessing, right? Like, and acknowledging and validating and affirming, you are an artist, right? If you create, that's who you want to be in the world, then you are, right? You don't need to have this grant or that schooling or whatever. It's sort of that building of community around affirming that we are creating and we're building worlds and we're, imagining, what's next, what can we build out of what's here, and holding space for grief. Again, I will, full circle it back, that's such a, there are rituals, that we build together partly to be able to be in grief with each other so that we can then, move to other ways. But, always, accepting that that is going to be a part of it, that love and joy, pleasure go with the grief and the rage and other feelings of that nature, that is all woven together. So that's pretty much it. I don't want to take up too much time. I don't know where I'm at time-wise. There are questions. I would love to answer them.
Shelvanaya, this was absolutely gorgeous, and I love that jump of when you affirm yourself as an artist and inviting others to be part of that creative journey.
Thank you, Pablo.
Really beautiful, really beautiful.
Thank you.
I think we are stretched a little bit for time.
Okay.
So I want to remind everybody that we are fundraising, and this is to empower more artists, innovators, and change makers from around the globe, more women, internationals, LGBTQ plus community, creatives, people from around the world to have access to this wonderful information and this wonderful group of people that brings out so many synergies and helps us connect to co-create a more beautiful world. And I want to introduce a very special someone, Alicia. Alicia is, well, Alicia's soul came placing into this body with a desire to be joyful and share love and be creative. Once a professional singer, she's also a visionary artist and current project director of the Vision Train, I've been on the vision train once, and it was absolutely gorgeous and beautiful and so resonant. And co-founding director of Bitra Academy. So Alicia, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Pablo. Thank you so much. And you know, we're on the vision train right now. Just to remind everybody, this is the vision train, and we're super grateful and proud to partner with Design Science on these salons. And that was how I found my way into design science. So I'm super grateful to all of you and to Roxy and the entire team. I'm going to try to share our story here as quickly as possible. So I'm going to just jump right on in. I'm here to share with you about the Vision Train and the art school that we birthed out of it called Vitra Academy. And here you see a picture of myself and my partner in creativity, Amanda Sage. And I would really be remiss to start telling the story without talking about this amazing fellow here named Ernst Fuchs, who is affectionately considered the grandfather of visionary art. And these are a few of his incredible paintings. And we have the great honor and privilege to be wisdom holders of this great technique that he brought back to modern painters called the Miche technique, which is an incredible indirect painting technique that allows for creation of incredibly beautiful, luminous paintings through layers of glazing colors. And here you see Amanda, my business partner, with Ernst Fuchs and his son, Michael Fuchs, who was Amanda's first teacher before she then came on to being Ernst's assistant for 10 years. And so, also out of the lineage of Ernst Fuchs, began these incredible summer seminars that happened in Italy that were started by this guy here in the center named Lawrence Caruana. And next to him is Amanda, and there's many colorful characters that you might recognize in this picture. I'm not sure that this is the first summer seminar, but I think it may be. And from these summer seminars birthed the Vienna Academy of Visionary Art. And that's really where my part of the story started to weave in. I joined the summer seminar in 2015, and the school was in Vienna. So I was so into it that I went to Vienna in 2016 to study. And at that point in time, I started working for the Academy, and came back in 2017 and 2019. And at this point, I also started teaching some of my own workshops. You'll see here some of my students from a workshop that happened in Ashland, Oregon in June 2018. And here you'll see, I started also assisting Amanda with some of her seminars that were in other places around the world. And here we were teaching a workshop in Los Angeles in January of 2020. And as all of you know, the world changed dramatically right after that. And that really opened up this call for the vision train to really be created. And on March 24th of 2020, the Nonstop Vision Train Global Art Jam left the station as a 24/7 virtual collaborative art studio. And in the last almost 4 years, over 3,000 artists and participants have been on the train since its inception and is kept on the tracks by a core crew of engineers, conductors, and writers, fueled by a passion for creative expression and collaboration. And so what happened was we really put an invitation out to people to start hosting their own trips. And for the first 8 months, we had a 24/7 packed schedule of different events and offerings that were happening here on this Zoom call. We also had these beautiful special events like this Earth Day celebration, where we invited Stephen Brooks and Alex and Allison Gray. We had incredible artists interviews, like this one here with Mark Henson. These are some of the core events that we had on the Vision Train. These individuals hosted these sessions for over a year, like weekly. Art of Dying with Lisette Murphy, Art Nuns was hosted by Carrie Ann Bada, Mythology Cafe with Christina Lazar. I was hosting. I still host Figure Studies here on Wednesdays. We also now do community artivism peace talks to help support artists and help connect them to other artists that may have similar visions for the artivism that speaks closely to their heart. And another initiative that is near and dear to us is the Vision Train Drawing Project. This was something that Amanda created as an incredible exercise for us all to, with words and images, bring our visions to of the new world into these train cars. So what does your train car look like? What part do you want to play in creating a world that works for all? Draw it out, write it out, and then link it into the Vision Train as we strengthen and support each other's visions coming into being. And I'll pop onto our website here in a little bit. You'll see if you go to visiontrain.org, you can download this template and print them out and scan them or send them back to us. There's thousands of these train cars that we've also gathered over the years. Here's a sweet picture. I think this may have been the first time that Amanda brought this into an elementary school and invited children to draw their visions. And simultaneously here at the beginning of 2020, the Vienna Academy of Visionary Art shut down. And so there were all these incredibly brilliant artists with all this time and energy to create and desire to connect, but we're all in our own homes, right? So we actually started to produce these fundraisers for the Vienna Academy. And I'm just gonna kind of skip through some of these because there's just so many that we did over a course of, I think, 6 or 8 months that year. And that really helped us. I probably should put this slide in a little bit different place, but here's some of the salons that we have also hosted here in this space with Design Science. Dissolve and Bloom, Making the Invisible Visible, and of course, Becoming the Regenaissance. We've had numerous exhibitions, Vision Train artists only, as well as exhibitions from our students' work, like this one, Transformation 2020. All the students from Amanda's transformation workshop submitted their work, and we had a virtual exhibition that you can actually walk through, like virtual reality style. And I'll show you guys a few of those as well. Here's another seminar that we produced that year. I mean, you guys, we probably produced like 50 different offerings here in the last year, or in the last few years. And it eventually became clear to us that we needed to make this into a real school ourselves. And so in 2020, on February 2nd, 2022, we opened Vitra Academy. And Vitra is an evolution of a golden thread of artist guilds, carrying a legacy of transmission by practicing masters to curious students. Conceived through a radical global shift, it is a response to the call for a container of creative, independent education and exchange. Vitra carries many meanings in different languages, though in essence, it is wisdom, knowledge, and points toward the way of the sage. At Vitra, we view the arts as sacred, relevant, and critical to our lives. We honor tradition while embracing creative innovation as vehicles for human evolution and global transformation. So our first term in 2022 last year was a very, it was very ambitious. We had a lot of offerings that spring. And, a lot of these courses have been remastered and are available on our website for you to watch at your own pace at www.vitra.academy. Incredible lectures, workshops, vision journeys, lunar eclipse sound baths. Shanita King is one of the evolutionaries that we met through design science. And this was really when we first started weaving in some of the community from design science into the Vision Train and Vitra Academy as well. Then we had a second term last fall. A little collage here so we don't have to skip through all of them, each slide at a time. We also had an incredible lecture again by Lawrence Caruana, who is the founder of the Vienna Academy of Visionary Art, and a full moon journey with his wife, the director, Florence Quepalitzli Menard. And we also finished last fall's term with Paint Your Light Tree with Amanda Sage. This is another course that is definitely remastered and available, and it's an incredible exercise walking you through the Miche technique, learning to create your initial monochromatic underpainting, and then glazing transparent layers of color over the top of it to create these, as you can see, incredibly luminous, beautiful, vibrant paintings. This spring, we partnered with Mark Henson and offered our first live in-person seminar in 3 years in San Francisco that was called The Mechanics of Nature. And we had, I think, 20 students from, and some traveling even from Europe to come to this this seminar. And it was a beautiful experience. Mark Henson is an incredibly prolific and poignant artist for our time. A lot of his pieces are incredibly iconic and speak a lot to what we're doing here in design science, where we're trying to build expressions of the world that we wish to see. This spring, we had a student exhibition where we invited students from the entire last year to submit works of art. I think there were over 100 pieces in this exhibition alone. And then, yes, this fall, we also welcomed Veronica Anderson, that we met through Design Science, to offer her deep design and creative empowerment courses here on the Vision Train. We had these incredible masterclass reviews where students submitted paintings that they were stuck on for Amanda to give them advice, and incredible digital mock-ups of moves that she would suggest they make. We had dynamic compositions and multi-point perspectives with Seth McMahon. Also with Harlan Emil Gruber from Design Science, we had two lectures based on his incredible book, Portal to the New Earth. And again, we partnered with Christina Lazar on this seminar, Visionary Beasts, Mythical Creatures in the Miche Technique. So this is really like how we wove together these two projects, and ultimately how one birthed the other. I also want to take us over here to the Vision Train website, where you can learn more about some of our initiatives, our projects, how to get to our Mighty Networks, where you can see our current schedule of events that are happening on the weekly basis here. And also show you our most recent initiative, which is also a fundraiser for the Vision Train, which is this art market. And the art market was inspired by Daily Visions, which was an invitation to create a new work of art every day for the entire year. So not all of them, but many of these pieces that are here in this art market have been created through the Daily Visions project. But we also have, and all of the pieces that are in this art market are less than $300. The artists that have submitted these works, many of them have donated the entire proceeds to support the Vision Train, but they have the option to choose anywhere from 50% to full donations. And we've got originals by Amanda Sage. This is an original painting by Christina Lazar, who's also one of our instructors. Beautiful archival prints of The Paintbrush Warrior and Wells of Souls by Mark Henson. Original works of art by Hani, He who splashed 1,000 worlds with color and know thyself. Hani is an Iranian artist that has been a cornerstone to the vision train community. Another print by Mark Henson. These are beautiful prints by Rosie, Illuminated Rose, Blue Medicine Buddha, and Eye of Gaia. This is a print of one of my pieces, Brushes Trump Bombs, The Great Wave of Change. Matriarchal Consciousness by Noor Tomei. I love this piece. This is an original as well. Some of these are original pieces that are just like, I mean, incredible opportunity to grab at these prices as well. Again, Family Tree of Light. This was a painting that actually was created by one of our students, Nicola Toa. Latola, in the Paint Your Light Tree workshop that I referenced a few minutes ago with Amanda Sage. And just look at this incredible piece that that was birthed from that workshop. Make it big. There we go. Beautiful piece by Nico. And this is a collaboration by between two of our Vision Train artists, Sani Kadihi and Joe Phillips. And they passed back and forth through the mail this wooden panel. And you'll see in the back, there's a little choo-choo train, the vision train coming towards you, this incredible character playing the guitar under the moon, the mandala moon, and this incredible tree with the owl. Another piece by Nicola Tola. Let It Out, Let It In by Molly Chopin. This is an original painting starting at $50. Online by Amanda Mollenbach. Another original piece. Let Me Clear My Throat by Brittany Monster. Love this one. And again, bidding on any of these pieces not only support the Vision Train, but the artists that have donated these pieces as well. Trishna is from India. This is an art print. This is a sweet piece, Break Fake Rules by Ian Paratore. This is an original collage, signed, varnished, and framed. And I welcome you guys to continue looking through these works of art. You can find them at visiontrain.betterworld.org. I'll drop the link in the chat, but you can also find it over here on our website. If you come to visiontrain.org, it's the very first thing that you see. You can click visit the art market and peruse. And a lot of the artists have submitted stories as well to share about their inspiration for these works of art. And you know, there's so many things that I could share with you about what the beautiful community members have brought to this space. But for lack of time, I tried to scale it back as short as I could, but even at that, it was 60 slides. Thank you guys so much for just hearing me out and being interested in the Vision Train and coming and sharing your interests here on this call with us today. We're super proud to be collaborating with Design Science on these salons, and I'm a proud alumni evolutionary of Cohort 2 and pod navigator of Cohort 3 this year. And so I've also really excited to have witnessed so many of our fellow cohorts projects today, and they're beautiful, vulnerable shares. And so I just wanted to share some gratitude for that as well. And please come back and visit us here on the Vision Train. Choo-choo!
Choo-choo! Wow, that was amazing. I feel like I didn't realize we were going to go through a whole retrospective, and it was just incredible. It deserves its own gallery exhibition of all of the posters and flyers and stories. You know, yeah. How people do like album.
Yeah, and I wasn't even able to open up the exhibitions. I mean, we have these cool exhibitions that you can walk through and walk up to the art, and I mean, there's so much to share, but I thought to just share the story of where we've been and where we're going.
Yeah, so many celebrations in the chat, so many Vision Train family members here, and we are such a woven family. It's been such a beautiful journey to go on together. We like very much came into the world together in a similar time and have been linked train cars, and we always want to host in the train to continue to direct people's energy to know that it's here and that it's a home for them. And that there's so much kind of so many masters and creative people who are continuing to share their wisdom and their gifts. And so thank you for continuing to uplift so many important practices and mediums and visionaries. It's really, yeah. Yes, Stella, big congratulations. It's
Yeah.
amazing.
Thank you guys. Much love.
Much love, Alicia. And yeah, Alicia is such a big part of the stewardship team in the studio, and Amanda Sage too. So much gratitude. All right, I'm going to bring Pablo back up while I get this video ready. Hola, Pablo.
Hola. Hi, everybody. So that was absolutely wonderful. And I really want to dig deep into the Misha technique, try to understand this elevation of color and the luminescence, and wow, I'm like like it's overwhelming. It's so beautiful. I wanted to introduce our next speaker. Actually, it's a pre-recorded video that Roxy's organizing, but Benjamin Vong Wong. His work lies at the intersection of fantasy, photography, and combines everyday objects with shocking statistics. So I think Roxy, you're gonna put the video on. Yeah, this is wonderful.
Yes. All right. Thank you, Pablo. And yes, welcoming Benjamin Von Wong from Cohort 2. Amazing stuff in the world. So excited. He's actually on a bamboo farm right now in Thailand, working on a large scale bird sculpture where all of the feathers are made out of biochar. That's why he couldn't be here live, because he's in a different time zone. Pretty amazing.
Hello, friends at the Design Science Studio. My name is Benjamin Von Wong, and this is the kind of work that I create. When people look at my work, one of the feelings that I hope that they get is a moment of curiosity. What am I looking at? Is this real? Is this fake? I think in a world where no one is really listening to each other right now, curiosity is key because curiosity breeds conversation, and conversation leads at least to the first steps of social change. And so when someone asks me, what am I looking at? I get to say, oh, this is actually a photograph of an art installation that I built. And the reason why it's glowing is because we had LED light strips behind the entire structure. And this art installation was built over the course of 2 weeks with the help of dozens of volunteers inside of a giant mall because I don't know how to build anything on my own. And those little lines that you see that make up the entire structure, well, those are single-use plastic straws, 168,000 of them, in fact, that we collected, cleaned, organized to create a Guinness World Record art installation made out of 168,000 plastic straws to show how small little decisions added up. I see the power of art in direct contrast to science, not as opposition to science, but rather a piece of science that can work together because headlines are important, science is important, but sometimes it's hard to capture people's attention for any extended period of time. And so, how do you get people to come back to important science? How do you get them to rediscover something that may be important? Well, I think art comes into play. These set of headlines here focus on the clothing that we wear, polyester, nylon, spandex, all of these things release microscopic pieces of plastic when we wash our clothes. And those pieces of plastic then get eaten by plankton, and then plankton get eaten by fish, and we eat that fish. And what I thought would be interesting would be to highlight how our clothing was coming back to haunt us, right? A simple art installation made from cardboard, fishing wire, and clothing to take something that was metaphorically a problem and actually give it a visual in a unique and interesting way. I also think art can really help support graphs and facts and figures. I was invited recently by Greenpeace to create an art installation that talked about the the energy consumption of Bitcoin mining, which is more than some countries. And I ended up conceptualizing a giant 11-foot tall skull with coal smokestacks coming out of its head with the Bitcoin laser eyes that are so symbolic. And that symbol that I created ended up being utilized by Greenpeace for their reports, for some merchandising, and remixed for their entire campaign. And I think art can sometimes be much more than just a single piece, but rather a flashpoint for more conversations to happen, an invitation for others to remix it. And in that way, it can really help to support a movement and to create and spark more conversations, regardless of where this happens to be. So I actually have a background as a photographer. And one of the earliest lessons that I learned was that even if you're a visual artist, it is really important that you think about how people are going to talk about the work that you do. One of my earliest campaigns that went viral was when I decided to tie a model 30 meters underwater in a shipwreck in Bali. And as you can hear, the words that I use to describe the photo are just as interesting as the photographs themselves. Actually, even if I didn't show you the image and I said, hey, I took a photo of a girl that we tied underwater, 30 meters underwater in a shipwreck in Bali, do you want to see it? It still feels compelling. And so these words really matter when we try to describe visuals. And if you are an artist and you want to get your works, I think it's always important to consider, how do we make sure that the work we create is interesting enough in words so that people want to interact with it? This was a piece that I created when you put superheroes on the edge of a 40-story skyscraper. And this one here was a recreation of a real world Beauty and the Beast. And so one of the big questions for me as I kind of moved from doing stunt-based photography into the world of impact was, how do I take that same catchiness that I had with my fantastical and surreal work, and how do I invite that into the social impact space? And I guess I got fairly lucky because I found a formula that sort of worked when it came to taking large volumes of material and figuring out ways to remix that into an interesting way. When we think about human consumption of different materials, it's quite overwhelming how much we go through. And so finding access to trash, which is a very like low cost material, is actually surprisingly easy. I found a bunch of abandoned clothing in Cambodia a couple years back. And I'd learned that a single cotton t-shirt that we wear uses 2,500 liters of water, which begs the question, what does our entire closet look like? Would probably look like a waterfall. And so finding unique and interesting ways to combine data and art, to me, felt like a really fun and powerful combination. And as I started getting better at doing these projects, different brands started coming to me asking if I could do the same for the cause or material that they were playing around with. And in this case, it was with Dell, the computer company, and they really wanted to raise awareness for electronic waste, since they're the largest electronic waste recycler in the world. Electronic waste is the fastest growing municipal waste stream. It has less than 15% of it is recycled, and 70% of the toxic waste in landfill actually comes from electronic waste. And so, you know, when I try to conceptualize projects, I try to make them familiar yet unique. And so I tend to borrow from different elements of popular culture and remix them together in a way that is unique and different. This over here is a set of computers arranged like solar panels in the opening scene of Blade Runner 2049. I created this backdrop to look like the background of circuit boards using used electronics, and combined that with a character with some body paint like Tron. And what you end up having is a piece that hopefully tells the story of using past technologies to power future devices. And maybe my most successful project of all was when I decided to put a mermaid on 10,000 plastic bottles. And we created an entire series featuring a mermaid struggling in 10,000 plastic bottles, effectively taking something that we maybe grew up with as children, have a real human emotional connection to, and sort of corrupted it in some way. And so you have this intersection of beauty and tragedy all woven together. You know, when I do these projects, and I think that when many artists create art, I think we tend to think about success of a project sort of like this. It's a question of how many different articles and featurettes can we get by different news organizations, how much visibility can we get, how many people can see it, how many people like it. But I think that the headlines that actually truly matter are the ones that are mostly invisible. They're the headlines that we very rarely get the chance to see, which is, what have we changed, or who has been changed by the work that we are creating? I created this project in 2016, and it was only in 2021 when the pandemic was in full swing, or 2021. When I received a Google alert for my name from Vice. And this was during the pandemic. I was locked at home and I was very confused. I was kind of wondering, why did I get tagged in this project? And it turns out that there was an article, a headline that was written not about me, but rather about another social entrepreneur who had credited me for starting her company and quitting her day job that was all about upcycling plastic bottles because of the photographs of mine that she saw. And I think those are the headlines that actually really matter. Those are the ones that are really important. And those are the ones that are often invisible. You know, one of the challenges, I think, of being an artist is that the world that we live in is constantly changing. It doesn't really matter how good we get, but whether it's the algorithms or the way we get attention, like, that's constantly changing. And so even though we may have figured out a certain formula to be seen, it can get really depressing over time because, you know, once upon a time, for example, we just take Instagram as a microcosm. Once upon a time, Instagram used to prioritize unique and different things. And then they moved on to doing things that were slightly different, like very similar, but slightly different. And then it suddenly became about Instagram Reels. And now we probably have like the whole world being flooded by these sort of artificially generated artificial intelligence, you know, art pieces. And you just start wondering, like, well, why is it even important for me to keep doing the work that I do if I can type in a couple of words and a couple of prompts and I might be able to create a piece that I maybe could have photographed a couple of years before? And I think this is something that we sometimes can get really frustrated by as creatives and just wonder, like, oh, like, how are we going to survive? Is this all going to work? And the truth is, like, I don't know if there's a way around it. Like, the world is constantly going to change and we just need to figure out how to adapt to it. We need to figure out what our role is in an ever-changing ecosystem. And that's just part of the job description, part of what it means being human in a modern world. And making sure that no matter what arises, that we continue to push through regardless, and that we believe in, I guess, human ingenuity and our own perseverance to constantly think of unique and interesting things. You know, once in a while, you do a project that actually makes a difference, but you can never tell which ones these happen to be. In my case, one of my latest wins was building this giant art installation in front of the United Nations, where 1,500 delegates from 193 different countries came together to sign a piece of paper around the global plastics resolution. This was a piece that I wasn't paid for, that I'd actually fundraised for myself, produced on my own, got permission from the United Nations, and somehow miraculously pulled this project through. And you know, I did this all with the sort of the hope of just creating work that would be seen in a place that I knew it would be important. And it ended up being successful enough to being placed in the right place so that all these delegates from all these different countries came in and used this as a symbol to photograph how we needed to turn off the plastic tap. And it was actually so popular within the movement that at the end of the day, you know, just a couple months ago, the United Nations decided to use this to talk about the to release it on their global plastics report. So I think that when we try to do art, we can never know when something is successful. For every project that I've shown you here today, there were tons of projects that never got to see the light of day, or that weren't, even if they did see the light of day, were just not even that successful. But movement supporting art, I think, is one of those gambles where you can have an asymmetrical upside. Once you create something that is truly unique and striking, it can reverberate across the entire movement, and you just never know when that next piece is actually going to be, whether it's a personal piece, whether it's a paid piece. You kind of just have to have faith that at some point you're going to create something. If you stick at it long enough, if you're good enough, if you're strategic enough, that you can somehow create work that you're actually proud of and that actually does make a difference. I think that too often we think about trying to measure the impact of the work that we do, but the truth is, social change, I think, is much less about that moment when ice shifts to water, but maybe it's an imperceptible change in temperature that we can't actually yet feel on our skins. And so it may be impossible to quantify, but it is absolutely necessary. You know, I'm sure you guys are all familiar with this trifecta of Simon Sinek's, which talks about the importance of starting not with what you do, not with how you do, but why you do it. But a prerequisite of talking about why for so many of these causes, movements, organizations, nonprofits, is that not everyone cares about everybody else's why. Curiosity has to be earned. And I think that curiosity is earned by those who are able to add a little sparkle to the entire thing. It's not just about why, but also about making sure that people are interested, they're curious, they want to know a little bit more about whatever that issue happens to be. And that's where the work that you do actually comes in and is extremely important. And so thank you so much for being part of the Design Science Studio. I wish you a great journey and get out there and create amazing work, even if you don't know whether or not it's going to matter or change or make a difference, because it absolutely will. You just have to have faith. Thanks, guys.
Awesome. You guys, I dropped a few links in the chat about Benjamin's work and where to find him. But I really hope that he can feel the gratitude. I'm so inspired by the idea of using basically waste, right, to create incredible works of art. And the fact that he had a piece that was even like on the cover of a UN report just goes to show that, you know, the initiatives that we strive to create, some of them really do make lasting impact. And so I'm really grateful for him for sharing his work, and super inspired as well. I'd love to get him on the vision train. And up next, we have Pamela Giaroli. Pamela is an artist and fabricator who transforms reality into innovative creations, scraps to furniture, moments to media, visions to a sustainable future. Sounds like we have a pretty good segue from Benjamin's work into Pamela's.
Thank Welcome, you, Pamela. Hi. Well, I'm excited to be in my second year at DSS. And as Wong, I mean, he's part of the of what inspires me to actually make what I make, which is a film about all of this. So today I'm sharing a storyboard summary of the film, which features characters who are artists, builder, filmmakers, who wants to change the world. And as a collective consciousness, multiple stories are nested together. So sometimes it's hard to tell if we're just in the past, the future, or just some kind of alternative universe. So my hope is that the plot backcast a very real path to the regenerative evolution. So the story starts with Handy Girl, one of the main characters. She is walking up the stairs of a Manhattan loft to visit her friend, a film producer. They are meeting up to bounce ideas on each other's film projects. Handy Girl is also receiving a package that she has sent to the loft. It contains VR goggles for an unconventional meeting with the CEO of a major investment firm, who is making headlines as the first to invest entirely in regenerative practices. As a philanthropic side project, she just bought an abandoned building where she wants to create a maker space, a marketplace, and an art gallery. She wants to hire Handy Girls Cooperative of Women Contractors for the renovation. Handy Girl puts her goggles on and enters the CEO virtual office. The CEO opens up the virtual net and shows Andy Girl the plan for the building she's renovating. Next, she starts navigating her AI network to bring Handy Girl to the virtual museum where all the art is connected to her regenerative investments. Wanting Handy Girl to fully understand her work and her vision, she brings her over to the centerpiece of the museum called the Mother Earth Message. It's a video piece where Mother Earth announces that she is reclaiming management of the planet. She's establishing a new economy centered around regeneration and the restoration of balance. And she is inviting everyone to become a citizen of this new Earth system, a borderless Earth of interconnection. At this point, the film cuts into a script, and we are transported to a Brooklyn apartment where we see a Gen Z version of the characters we just met. They have known each other since kindergarten. Amina is a woman of color with a master in finance. She chose to do an internship at BlackRock with the hope of trying to change the system from the inside. But she quickly learned that the system is well resistant to change. She's now more determined than ever to start her own company, reshaping how investment works with a focus on sustainability and ethics. Karuk has indigenous roots. She grew up in Brooklyn, and she has struggled to connect with her heritage while her family wanted her to blend in. She's a water protector, an activist, and works at an organization that supports the conversion of companies to worker-owned cooperatives. She strongly believes in her work and knows that cooperatives are the way of the future. Handy Girl is an Italian immigrant and moved back to Italy when her parents divorced in her early teens. She would return to Brooklyn in the summer to spend time with the girls and her dad, but constantly struggled with mental health. She moved back to New York after high school because her dad got sick. She later inherited his brownstone where the girls are now living together. With the help of Karuk, she is dreaming about opening a women contractor cooperative. The friends are discussing the film they are writing as a marketing strategy for Amina's new investment company. They grew up playing pretend games about how to change the world, from imagining world peace, the market crashing and setting everybody free, instead of the military, armies of world builder creating new efficient city, revolutionizing agriculture and expanding the forests. Growing into a completely decentralized infrastructure organized by a neutral and fair artificial intelligence that promotes regenerative evolution. The girls, now they are older, are strategizing about how to make it reality. They know that they can't just take the system down all at once. This society has too many walls and barriers constructed to avoid such an evolution. They cannot fight this rigged system, but they can use it to get where they need to go. This is where Amina's strategy comes in. She wants to create a token system that allows people to literally get into business directly with Mother Earth. And they know that the only way to resist the opposition will be to build a movement. To do that, they will turn the Earth investment into a democratic game where people's everyday choices shapes the future. Now another script closes, and we are back in the Manhattan loft with the older Andy girl and her film producer friends. The film producer loves the movie concept and gives Andy girl a list of next steps. She needs to get collaborators to work on a trailer, get in a writer rooms to develop the script, and get funders. The producer thinks the film can be some kind of instruction on how to change the world, and she's impatient to see it happen. It's time to start telling the story from the future about the film that changed the world. The end. All right.
I love your storytelling, Pamela, and I feel like it also harkens back to the session that we had with Leah earlier today and also earlier this week.
Yeah.
Kind of the back casting, you know, and telling the story of the evolution from the point that it's already taken place, you know. And I am Mother Earth is such a profound mantra, you know, something to remind ourselves, you know, like we are nature. I am Mother Earth.
So I'm just like shouting out to for collaborators who are interested in expanding the script. I mean, the script was way bigger, but I definitely want to.
Yeah, and I know there are definitely some filmmakers in the community as well. I would love to see that played out in action.
All right. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much, Pamela. Our next presenter hardly needs introduction. As a matter of fact, in here, in his bio, it just says Galactic Transformation Agent. But I have the extreme pleasure of introducing my friend and great inspiration, Harlan Emil Gruber. Harlan received a degree in environmental science and environmental design from Parsons School of Design in 1985. And he makes a wide variety of art and design projects, culminating in large scale interactive portal installations featured at Burning Man since 2004. Through the use of sacred geometry, color and sound vibrations, the portals are intended to facilitate an evolution of consciousness. His new book, Portal to the New Earth, explains the portals and sacred geometry in detail, but most importantly, shows how cities can be created in a conscious, regenerative way to benefit all life and the earth. And we also had the pleasure of welcoming Harlan to Vutra Academy for two lectures this fall as well. Thank you so much, Harlan, for all that you do and the beautiful ways that you inspire us.
Oh, great. Thanks, Alicia. And thanks, everyone here for all these great presentations we've been getting to experience. So, this presentation is going to actually focus directly on this project that I've been developing. That was my original submission for when I joined the first cohort back in 2020. You're just thinking, oh, I'll just develop this. And then, of course, it turned into this overarching project, which includes everything that I'm working on, which I actually just added to the homepage of the website. It's in the latest newsletter, these five-fold things. But what I'm going to just throw in here now is not the link to the homepage, but in the chat is the link to the book. And there's a link to actually be able to see the book as a PDF. And chapter 8 of the book is what we're going to be kind of covering in this brief presentation right now. So let me just jump into sharing my screen. And of course, it starts off with, slideshow, start from the start there. And I think you can see Bucky holding some incredible tensegrity with that famous quote, "You never change things by fighting the existing reality. To change something, build a new model that makes the existing model obsolete." And so what I'm going to talk about now is this model of a three-dimensional ecologically integrated city that might make the existing models obsolete. And, you know, this is something I've been thinking about, but it hasn't been fully, you know, developed. It's a concept. So where did this concept for this 12 spiral city come from? And let's see, here we go. So shortly after learning about Buckminster Fuller and synergetics and reading a lot of his other books, I came across the Italian architect Paolo Solari's concept of arcology in an exhibition in New York City in a gallery in 1981. I was like, what was it? 21 years old. And there was these scroll drawings, of which this is an excerpt of, that wrapped all the way around the gallery, of these fantastic, organic-looking three-dimensional cities. And so I bought a copy of the book, Arcology, City in the Image of Man, which was published actually back in 1969 by MIT Press. So, he's got quite a notable background, and this is the cover of the book, which shows a cross section through one of these fantastic, huge, three-dimensional megastructure cities. And the book is divided in two halves. I'd just like to show a quick excerpt of how in the first half of the book, he just talks about like thinking and mapping things out in these flow diagrams. But the second half of the book shows a lot of these quick sketches of what he was thinking about, arcologies of these mile or two wide, many thousands of feet high, three-dimensional structures that would be, like he calls them, arcologies, integrated completely with ecology. So as much as they're like a harsh megastructure, it also means that it's fully integrated with gardens and growing things. And it's like the whole city itself is growing. So that made me start to think of my own city. Here it is, the 12 spiral city, sacred sacred geometry arcology. Well, one of the huge inspirations was something I learned shortly thereafter. I enrolled in Parsons School of Design to study environmental design. And when you're in a design school, you get to do a lot of art history. And I came across this project by Griswold Ting, ironically created the same year that the book Arcology was published, 1969. Now, mind you, I'm studying now, it's still a long time ago, but it was in the mid 80s. So 69 was a lot earlier than that. These were much older, not contemporary projects from when I was learning about them. And as you see, it's a series of spiraling ramps with the buildings spaced around this, really cool integrated spiraling ramps. What's very interesting is that although from around the same time, 1970, I only just learned of Wolf Hilbert's and his concepts of actually growing cities the way coral reefs grow in this beautiful, iconic spiraling form. And you see this integral structure, which very much relates again to this idea of how cities can be in multiple layers, like that spiral hierarchy. Also around, this was somewhat contemporary to that time, actually it was shortly thereafter, this book, Dimensions of Paradise by John Michel, which has on the cover this incredible diagram that you see fully fleshed out. And this shows how it comes about. These 12 circles spaced in four sets of three around a central circle in a very sacred geometrical diagram. Here it is rather distilled into its essence. So I took these ideas of spiraling the urban spiral hierarchy, this 12 circles around one, the New Jerusalem Heavenly City. And this was a presentation I did back in 2008. I made this model. And you see in the very lower right of this diagram, this model, but you'll see it a little bit better here where you see the model. This is just six spiraling levels. That's as much time as I had in making this. But this shows the proportions of the spiraling ramps. And in that lower left corner, you see that these ramps are a little over 300 feet wide and 144 feet high, which would leave the space to build human-scale buildings with inner, outer, and central roads, and then integrated with gardens on the rooftops and in between the buildings. Also you see, just in sense of scale to San Francisco, how big such a structure would be, a couple of miles across. Each of those spirals are 2,060 feet in diameter. The overall city is a little over 10,000 feet. And so here is a computer-generated image showing the ramps spiraling up in, their proportions with human scale. Now, of course, this is very crude in that the buildings are all these perfect little blocks and the intersecting towers are very, you know, just look like a big glass skyscraper. And here is the overall 12 spirals high, which would make it about 1,700 feet high. Not all that high compared to modern skyscrapers, which, you know, go many, many thousands of feet high. But it is quite a bit taller than, you know, the skyscrapers I grew up with, like the Empire State Building, which is just a little over 1,000 feet. And from ground view looking up at it. But mind you, I really need to start working with integrating these very crude images with AI images, of which this is a beautiful ecologically integrated houses. And here is a view into a canyon, also AI generated, of these different terrace streets with these various domes and buildings integrated directly into it. So imagine this type of view superimposed on this structure. And in the center areas would also be communal spaces in between these spiraling ramps. But the spiraling ramps themselves are very much growing over time. And I've even come up with this idea of how the ramps themselves have more opening space in it to allow more sunlight to penetrate through it. But like I say, it really is a vision of how a city, an arcology, can grow upwards over time. Again, we'll end with another couple of these AI generated. And mind you, I found these images a few years back now, I think. And I need to really learn how to integrate this kind of AI technology with that. But more than just AI, to create such a space in virtual reality, which I have no skills in creating virtual reality experiences, but even to make like the 12 Spiral City a virtual reality game where different people can come and build their own homes or own businesses in those central towers that connect the ramps together. So if you want to, you know, learn more about this, like I say, go click on that link I put in there for the Portal to the New Earth /book, and you can just read that one chapter. Of course, you can read the whole book, but the one chapter isn't that long. It's only, you know, maybe 10 pages, I think, and it shows those same images. And let's see, I'll stop my share, and that's pretty much what I wanted to present. I mean, obviously, in the interest of time, I think that's about my allotted time slot to present this concept of the 12 Spiral City with you today, and to invite people to collaborate, you know, to come, and if there are people that can do virtual reality kind of, you know, programming, to work together to create a 12 Spiral City in virtual reality, or people who know how to work with AI imageries to make the, you know, more detailed visions of what this 12 Spiral City actually could look like. So thank you so much for joining me for this today.
Yes, awesome, Harlan. Thank you so much. It's always a treat to get to get see into your designs and your ideas and sharing. You know, you're prolifically studied so many others that are in this movement. And so you're just a wealth of information. That's something that I've been so impressed with from you is just how much this is really just, you know, you can speak to it so clearly because it's so well ingrained in your mind. So thank you so much for sharing again. Also, just wanted to remind everybody that this is a fundraiser, Becoming the Regenaissance. And this is all essentially for our Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Scholarship Access Fund. And this really makes these teachings and this incredible program that Roxy and the team have put together equitable and accessible to people that would not be able to participate otherwise. And this is certainly prioritizing people of color, LGBTQ+. And this is something that is at the core of the design science mission, is to be able to make these teachings available to as many people as possible. In the last few years, it's something about $350,000 in participant scholarships, 266 global projects launched, 373 innovators from 42 countries, which is incredibly impressive as well. So you can scan the QR code here on the bottom corner to donate. Thank you again to whoever donated $2,023. Super grateful for your support. And again, this all makes this available to this project, this program available to as many people as possible. Design Science Studios Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Scholarship Access Fund. No amount is too small. So appreciate your support. All right, you guys, I think we're going to take a short little break and shut the recording down and set up reset the restream. So we'll take a little bio break. You guys can look away from the computer, take a little bio break, grab some water, and we'll hop back in here in just a few moments. Thank you for joining us today for Becoming the Regenaissance with Design Science Salon. My name is Alicia Sacred Heart. Thank you. And